Like Neuralink. Yeah. This is something I think we've spoken a few times offline about. Speaking of computer vision, I'm fascinated by the eye. I did a bunch of work on the eye. So there's the neuroscientist, there's the neurobiology way of studying the eye, and there's the computer vision way of studying the eye. And the computer vision way of studying the eye, of just like observing, non-contact sensing of humans, is really fascinating to me. And studying human behavior in different contexts, like in semi-autonomous vehicles, it seemed like there's a lot of signal that comes from the eye, that comes from blinking, that's not fully understood yet. It's been in the lab, it's been used quite a bit to study like the dilation of the pupil, all those kinds of things are used to infer workload, cognitive load, all those kinds of things. But the pictures is murky. It's not completely well understood, especially in the wild, how much signal you can get from the eye, from the human face. I've downloaded Joe Rogan's, all of the podcasts he's ever done, video.
You have the YouTube bank.
I have the YouTube bank for a reason that this was before he went with Spotify.
You own the archive. There's PubMed, and then there's the Joe Rogan Experience, owned by
Lex,
or maintained by Lex. Lex
privately Fridman. For my private collection. No, the reason I did it, and I did the really like rigorous processing of it, which is like I extracted all of the faces. I did the really good blink track, the pupil tracking, and the blink detection for the entirety of the. I should say it's from episode like. I forget what it is, but it's like episode 900 when they switched to 1080p video. It was like much crappier video. It's still kind of.
Did you log when there was marijuana consumption or when they were drinking?
When they're smoking. I mean, there's so many.
That's going to it won't throw off the data, but it's relevant to
it's relevant
to the pupil data.
So let's just put it this way. There's a lot of fascinating computer vision problems involved, but I only kept long sequences of data where the eyes detected exceptionally well. And I also removed people that were wearing glasses. I removed, there's certain people that have a way of moving their eyes and squinting where it's harder to infer like concrete blinks. Mm-hmm. You know, they'll kind of have a squint the whole time. Mm-hmm. And their blink is very light. It's very tough to know what's an actual blink. So I wanted
then you got those baseball cap wearing guys. There are certain people that go on podcasts and wear baseball caps and don't reveal their, I don't know if they realize it or not until it comes out, but their face is completely obscured from vision.
And from a computer vision perspective, people that wear makeup, and usually women on their eyes, it complicates things. Like eyelashes, all complicate things. So, you can clean stuff up just so you have really crisp signal. You don't have to. You can deal with issues, but, you know, there's so many hours of Joe Rogan video. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I say all that because I was searching for an interesting personal experiment for me I saw in drivers, when I was looking at eye movement in drivers, it seemed to indicate, there seemed to be quite a lot of signal there that indicates amount of cognitive load. But it's not clear if there's something conclusive. But if there is some signal, that's a really powerful one, because eye movement can be detected in the wild. Like you and I sitting here, I can detect eye movement really well. Pupil dilation is a really crappy indicator.
And it's luminance dependent. Like if I turn toward a light, it's arousal. Pupils change size depending on level of alertness, autonomic arousal, but also overall levels of luminance. It's very, very hard. But there are, I mean, you're sitting on a gold mine because there is a lot of interest right now in measuring state through non-contact sensing.
Yes.
Heart rate variability through changes in skin tone. Just off a camera, can you imagine that? At the point where you just look at some video and you're like, oh, they're getting more stressed or worked up, and they're not, based on a heat map of some little patch on their face, because everyone's going to have this slight, you know, sort of compartmentalize it slightly differently, but you can learn it pretty quickly. We know this when someone's like giving a talk and we see them starting to get blotching mm-hmm. on their neck. You know, this is the the thesis defense response, yeah. Right? We know it, and it's a stressful situation because not passing your thesis defense is rough. And we can see that, but cameras can pick that up really easily at much lower levels than the blatant blotching kind of effect. And eye movements certainly are powerful indications of the state of the autonomic system.
So what do you think there are things from a high level that you can pick up from eye movement and blinking?
Well, blink frequency is going to increase as people get tired. Right. I've actually been teased a lot online because I don't blink much when I'll do a post. And so I did a whole post about blinking, about the science of blinking. There's some data, very strong data, not from my lab, that show that every time you blink, it resets your perception of time. They have people do these kind of track a kind of a Doppler-like thing. And anyway, blinking resets your perception of time. There's a dopaminergic mechanism in the blink-related circuitry of the brain. When people are very alert, they tend to not blink very much. When we're sleepy, we tend to blink more and our eyes tend to close. Now, some people are more hooded in the way their eyes sit. Mm-hmm. Some people are like this all the time. There are some very famous people, I'm not going to name them because I might run into them at some point, who are like accused of being sociopaths because they don't blink very often. Mm. But they might just have high levels of autonomic arousal. They just don't blink very much.
Yeah.
It also depends on how lubricated the eyes are. So I think within individual.
Yes.
You can get a lot of information. I don't think we can say this person's blinking a lot, they're lying, this person, or they're tired, this person doesn't blink, they're stressed. I think if you understand that person's baseline, you can get it. And presumably, having been on the Joe Rogan Experience, I can say when you first sit down there, if you've never been in there before.
You're in my data set, by the way.
Oh my. Well, I bet you I will admit to being, you know, first time sitting down there. I mean, Joe was incredibly gracious, made me feel very comfortable there, but it's an intense experience. It's a small space too. Anytime you enter a small space from a big space, in his old studio, you're familiar with, there's a breaking in period where you're getting to know somebody. And so I'm sure my levels of autonomic arousal front of the podcast were higher than later. So, but once you have a baseline established, you can get a lot of data on somebody simply from blinks. Some people averting gaze too. If you have both people, that's really powerful. This is the holy grail of another holy grail of neuroscience. We've mainly looked at subjects in isolation. There hasn't been much brain imaging of two people interacting, or even in animal models of two mice or two monkeys interacting. It's all that's like brilliant. Person scanner, bite bar. I mean, if you've ever been in one of these scanners, you're like in a bite bar. It's very medieval.
And so you think in the interaction, there's actually, you can almost study them as a single brain or as a single system. The two brains are a single system.
I think with AI.
Highly correlated.
Yeah, maybe are your blinks triggering my blinks? Like, yeah. You know, are your non-blink epochs, you know, extending my non-blink epochs? There's a fascinating space to explore there and no one's done it. And because everyone let the Joe Rogan Experience archive disappear, except for you. You grabbed.
Well, actually,
did you get the comments too? Because I think the comments were almost as entertaining as the conversation.
You know what you just made me realize with the couplings? I have a better data set than the Joe Rogan podcast with high resolution video, which is the raw video for this podcast. So for example, both cameras right now are recording you and I full feed. Mm. The final result will switch cameras back and forth, but I have the full feed.
Right.
So I can have the blinking for both you and I the whole time.
I bet you people trigger blinks and in one another, you know, and there's also like the simplest way to think about the blinks and the attentional thing and the alertness is two fighters in the standoff. There's this whole lore around who blinks first.
Yeah.
It's like they blink first. Well, what are we really asking? They're asking whether or not one person can maintain focus longer than the other person, which is an important parameter. It's not the only parameter, but it's an important parameter. And so that blinking contest, even though they don't square off as a blinking contest, it's well known that the first to blink is revealing something about their capacity to hold attention.